Okay, now we're on to part B of this session, session A, about death and dying. We were ending with part A, talking about, you know, the spiritual care. And, you know, be aware that a lot of times the anxiety and fear that someone may demonstrate, you know, while they're dying, is not so much a fear of dying, but a lot of times it is fear of dying alone. For that reason, you know, a lot of times, a lot of nursing homes will transfer the resident, if they're in a double room, to a private room, so the family can sleep over if they desire. Some nursing homes have even gone to like hospice rooms and made like a little efficiency apartment out of one of their rooms with sleeper sofas for chairs and a little microwave and coffee makers and a small refrigerator, and even put a private shower in there for the family. So somebody is dying, listen well to them. Because a lot of times when you listen to somebody, you can literally hear them cry. Avoid, you know, do not isolate them at all. A lot of times, you know, people tend to stay away from people that are dying. They're afraid they're going to bother them. No, they probably want the company. Don't judge anything that they say to you, because it could be spoken out in anger, either from the resident or from their family. Understand they're going through something that they've never gone through before. Notify the nurse if there's any questions, if they need a spiritual care counselor, so they can get that call, get their pastor, their minister out there, or if they're on hospice, get the spiritual care coordinator out there, get their priest out there, their rabbi, you know, whoever basically that they are asking for. Provide them with privacy, and just keep them safe. Now, as the body goes into the dying process, and understand this is individual, it goes rapid in some folks, it goes slower in others, but here's some of the signs that you'll see of approaching death. The skin will start to show a pallor and a cyanosis. The tips of the fingers, the tips of the toes, or the tips of the earlobe will start to turn kind of a bluish color. The skin will get cold as circulation starts to slow down. The skin temperature will change and the skin will turn cold. The skin will look like it's bruised, either on the arm or on the legs here. It's a patchiness, it's called mottling. And again, why that is happening is because circulation is slowing down. The heart is beating weaker and slower, and you know it's dying. And basically with that, the whole circulation slows down. They will sometimes sweat profusely. And of course, with that, skin care is going to be incredibly important. A lot of times they'll get a fever. You've got your car, and you know if you don't put fluid in the radiator, car is going to overheat. Well, it's the same thing with the human body. The person can't drink because of they just can't swallow, or they just don't have the strength or the will or the want to, so the body can overheat much like your car. This is where what we have to do is called the sponge bath, where you simply get some lukewarm water, not hot, not cold, just lukewarm, and just put it on their arms, maybe on their lower legs and their upper chest here, and leave the water droplet, the beads, on them and let it air dry. What will happen is the droplets will dilate or enlarge the pores of the skin here, and then heat can just, as the skin enlarges, and of course you won't visually see it, but as it will enlarge, the heat will just escape out through the dilated pores. And a lot of times you have to do that sponge bath, you know, pretty frequently to keep their fever down. You'll see extreme weakness and basically exhaustion, so they're going to need your help. Turning or anything like that. They simply won't have it themselves. We said earlier about the decreased senses. So seeing might be issues, and even hearing. They will have an inability to speak. They'll be extremely drowsy. They can get disoriented and even be confused as circulation is slowing down to extremities. That's why they're changing color. Circulation will also slow down to the brain, and that, of course, can cause confusion and disorientation and even hallucinations. The blood pressure will tend to drop, but the pulse will tend to rise. They kind of go in different directions. So again, the blood pressure will start to drop, and the pulse will start to increase. The Cheyne-Stokes respirations we talked about earlier, you're basically going to see them, okay, the pattern of stopping and starting. Swallowing becomes difficulty, the mouth can be very dry. Nausea and vomiting a lot of times can be a major issue. It's hard to control sometimes. Pain, I believe, is easier to control than nausea and vomiting. You know, some of the things you could try, possibly, that may work is raise the head of the bed up a little bit. If they can tolerate it, bank them over to their right side. Because it's this upper left part of the stomach is, putting it simply, is really ticklish. And if there's anything in the stomach and it gets near this upper portion here, it could stimulate the sphincter muscle to open and they throw up. But if you lay them on the right side, you'll get the food or anything in the stomach away from there. And you'll keep it down away from there and might be able to keep them from throwing up. I know one of the things that I was taught in nursing school was to get a clear pop, shake it, get all the carbonation gone, and then add some sugar to the soda pop. Kind of like the clear ones, okay? And you get all the carbonation gone, you add some sugar, and not cold, but just room temperature. And if they can, and here again, if they can, they sip on it. And it's something about the sugar quiets the nerve endings in the stomach sometimes. And here again, this doesn't work for everybody. You know, we try it, and if it works, hooray. We keep on doing it. If it doesn't work, we go on to plan B or plan C. Incontinence, of course, is really can be an issue sometimes as death nears. And it can really make people uncomfortable. The peri area, the skin care down there has to be immaculate because here again, there is acids in the BM and acids in the urine. If they lay on the skin, they will burn the top layers of skin. So we don't need to add injury to hurt by having them hurting in the peri area while they are basically dying. Urinary output will basically decrease. Now, what we basically see is after the person dies, you know, the major thing that we are basically, the charge nurse will come down, this is what they're assessing, that there's an absence of blood pressure, there's an absence of pulse, and there's an absence of respirations. And of course, when that is documented, then of course, that's when, you know, the person is basically pronounced. Family may be present or may not be present. And a lot of times, you know, they will be. We see this a lot in our nursing homes. And what we kind of do after the person dies is post-mortem care. And what we're doing with post-mortem care is basically a bed bath, okay? We're going to do a full bed bath. We're going to change the linens, we're going to change the sheets. A lot of times at the moment of death, the person is incontinent of urine. We're going to clean them very well. Raise the head of the bed up a little bit if it's not already up. That will kind of slow down the discoloration of the face a little bit. Bring the sheets up to about here. With the head up and in a nice gown or something like that, what we're doing is we're giving the appearance that the person is asleep. So the family is not traumatized by if they're not there, if they're coming in, so that the traumatized, you know, of losing a loved one is a little bit lessened because their loved one looks comfortable. A lot of times we'll get machinery out of the room so they don't have to see the suction machine or, you know, hear the oxygen machine running the concentrator or basically things like that. So in the post-mortem care, it is simply, like I said, giving the person a bed bath. Now, looking at the KDHE manual here, and like I said, it's part two, unit 18, just as a review here, you know, everybody has their own views of end of life. Hopefully, and this is one of the benefits of working in long-term care, is we get to develop a relationship a lot of times with our residents. And we know their likes and dislikes, and we know their beliefs and the things that mean a lot to them. So when the time of the end of their life comes, we're more prepared to basically serve them, to basically wait on them, or whatever you want to call it, but basically help them. Now, a lot of times, like, we will see people that have made decisions before that time comes, and they will have these papers that we talked about earlier, that like the Advanced Care Health Directive. And the Advanced Care Health Directive is just takes a notary, the person signs it and checks some boxes of what they do or don't want. And a lot of times your social worker is a notary also, or your administrator. And they basically say in advance the direction they want their health to go. It's really, really, like I said, it's very, very beneficial to the staff, because now we know what they want and what they don't want. So we're not all worried and tense and scared. Are we doing the right thing? Are we honoring them? Or are we doing something to them with the CPR that they did not want? The life-sustaining care, you know, it is up to their decision, you know, to basically what they want. A lot of people will basically say, no, I want to be kept comfortable and I want to be cared for. I don't want the extra, quote, heroic measures. The DNR, the Do Not Resuscitate, is a document that the person signs along with their physician, that should they stop breathing, you know, it's expected. We're not talking about the person who chokes on a hot dog here at supper, but the dying person, when they come to that point of when they stop breathing or their heart stops, do we start the CPR or do we not start the CPR? Well, with the DNR, Do Not Resuscitate, we basically do not, because it's their wishes. And like I said earlier, in the legal part, the durable power of attorney with health care decisions especially is the spokesperson for this individual. They basically can speak for that person when that person can no longer speak for themselves. Now, hospice, like I said, is a team that works together, physician, nurses, home health aides, a spiritual care counselor, a social worker, and even volunteers. They all work to basically give this person the best day that they can have. And they will each assess in their particular area if there's things that they need to take care of today. For the most part, the nurse, everybody looks at pain. And for the most part, that's where the nurse will specialize, pain and symptoms. The social work, I said, is emotional. The chaplain or spiritual care coordinator is just that, spiritual care. The volunteers are an integral role in hospice. They are people that just do that, volunteer their time. I've seen lots of volunteers do lots of different stuff, from everything to take a little boy fishing, to mow somebody's yard, to fix a roof, to rearrange some stuff in the house. What is the biggest thing that volunteers do is basically sit with the patient and while the family has to go take care of business. They don't do any hands-on care. If there's hands-on care that's required, basically they'll be calling the case manager for that. But they're literally giving a chance, like for maybe the wife is taking care of the husband in the private home. She needs to go to the beauty shop. Well, a hospice volunteer can go there for a couple hours and sit with the person, be a companion while they go out and take care of business. So, like I said, the whole team is basically geared for literally helping the person. And of course, CNAs work in hospice. A lot of hospices have them also take the additional home health aid training course and get more hospice directive education, you know, and get more specifics of taking care of a person who's dying in their home or the nursing home. And of course, that course is also offered here at Miami County campus too. Now when we talk about anticipating death, we are going to see people go through these stages of denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. But I really want to stress, it doesn't have to be in that order. A person can skip around, and just because a person does get to acceptance is no guarantee they're going to stay there. These are general things that we see that we can, as we recognize them, we know as far as our communication, our care to them, because we'd want to taper it. And what I mean by that, like for our communication, we would definitely talk to a resident in a different way if they were in anger as compared to one who was, say, in bargaining or depression. But the basic denial is just that. It's not me. You read the lab work wrong. You looked at the chest day wrong. It's not me. The anger is just that. Very upset over loss. A lot of times it can be vented on the staff. And a lot of times that anger in the long-term care facility is vented on the nurse aide, because it's the nurse aide that is by the bedside the most. So you've got to learn not to take it personal. You know, you've got to learn that, you know, you've been friends with them for, say, 12 months, and then all of a sudden they say something unkind to you. It is because of what they're losing. It's not because of you personally. It's what's being done to them, what the disease is basically stealing from them. And then as far as bargaining, like I said, that's usually an agreement made to prolong life. Depression is just that, dealing with the unavoidable reality of death. The person usually cries a lot, or they may be silent a lot. Some people will cocoon, like draw in, and be totally silent. And then, of course, acceptance, accommodation is basically recognizing, or at least acknowledging, that death is inevitable, and that, you know, they are basically going to deal with it. Remember, your families in your long-term care facilities may also go through these five stages. So be prepared to basically offer them help, assistance, and most of the help and assistance that we offer them is just simply a hug, a handhold, and an ear to basically listen. Identify the different emotions that a person goes through. And then, like I said, as the physical signs of approaching death start to happen, you're going to see slower functioning in the person. you're going to see decreased thirst and appetite, decreased ability to swallow. They may start to have noisy, very labored breathing and respiration. This is called dyspnea. The breathing may have a very irregular pattern, and they may also rattle. You know, all these things, you know, when you see these unusual things, now is the time to get a hold of the charge nurse to help that person. The heart will beat less efficiently, the pulse will get more irregular, the blood pressure will start to lower, less oxygen will get out to the body tissue. So this is where we see the skin changing colors, getting the blue called cyanosis. And it usually starts in the extremities, furthest away from the heart, the toes and the fingers, but then as time goes on, it comes back up the legs or down the arms, you know, toward the center of the body. The skin, moist and cool, it appears pale and dusky and does this mottling. The legs are what usually does most of this mottling. It'll be patchy red and white areas all up and down the person's leg. They'll be sleeping more, they'll be weaker more, they could be confused. Even in their sleep, they could be restless. So again, this flax system that we talked about earlier, be monitoring the person's face and legs and activity, their crying and consolability. Be monitoring that and be mindful that as you see it increasing, you need to let the charge nurse know, because it's easier, of course, to deal with any medical issue while it's small. Don't let the pain or whatever symptom you're dealing with, nausea, itching, skin itching, whatever it is, don't let the symptom get out of control. Deal with it while it's small. You know, let the charge nurse know when you see these things. They will have decreased urine output, and the urine will appear to be very concentrated. They will be incontinent more and more. If they don't have a Foley catheter in, more of urine in the course of bowel. So be prepared, basically, to do gentle, frequent pericare. And of course, this is where it's good, you having somebody with you to turn them, help you turn them while you clean them. It's extremely hard to turn somebody by yourself and to clean somebody all by yourself. You know, we kind of muscle them when we kind of do that. Well, these people here are hurting so bad, we don't want to muscle them over. We want them gently rolled over, and for that we basically need a helper. The supportive care for the dying resident, you know, basically position them for easy breathing. And here again, like I said, the head of the bed up will help. The fan, not high but low, but just a low air current will stimulate these sensors in our inner